No, the point I was making yesterday was that the ICC is a product of international politics, and it has to work within an atmosphere of international politics. If it depends upon member states signing up, that immediately puts it in the realm of politics. If it has to respect sovereignty and use the facilities of sovereign member states in order to do its work, that immediately makes it susceptible to politics. Now, international politics cannot be avoided where it has to be funded a certain way, where it has a small staff but depends upon the cooperation of member states who have signed up. It's unavoidable. Now, African states have referred cases to the ICC. So if you refer a case to the ICC, it seems to me a little strange that you complain that you are being targeted. Indeed, on its own motion, the ICC has two, the Security Council two, and African states referrals four. So it does not seem to me to be a good way to proceed by being the largest number of countries to have signed up, referring the largest number of cases, and then complaining about being targeted. I am saying, if you voluntarily accede to something, then you have to be careful how you complain. When you refer a case, you should expect results. But if you refer a case and you turn around and complain, then you seem a little difficult to follow. Yes, it's a product of international politics, no doubt about it. Even the referral. Governments are unlikely to refer their own friends or people on their side. They are likely to refer members of the opposition. So one has to be conscious of this and proceed accordingly. Perhaps the ICC could look elsewhere, but if you invite a guest into your home, you can't be here to complain so loudly. But we can dialogue with the ICC on the way it proceeds, because it's important for it to be seen as representing the world rather than Africa per se. But it's Africans who have gone there to complain. Isn't that right? I won't even use the word blame. I'm just saying some realism. Admittedly, some members of the Security Council who have not signed up, but who have the authority to refer cases, in a sense, undermine the moral standing of the court. But if you have taken your case there, you should not be here to complain that the matter is receiving attention and that too much attention is on you. Instead, you should take the strength of what you have and work with it. Transitional justice mechanisms have a way of being, I'm talking of the non-punitive mechanisms, have a way of engaging a bigger community than the penal ones. When you are trying leaders and so on, you may try a few people. They may make a point that some kinds of conduct are unacceptable, that leadership comes with responsibility, leadership comes with obligations, but the real perpetrators often are much lower down the ladder, and they don't get the kind of attention that they should get. At the same time, a bigger number of people, particularly if hearings are held in public, a bigger number of people can be a part of the process. And in that way, as people discuss in their homes, in their bars, in public places and so on, you shape public morality. So yes, in the sense that it enables a society to define what is a minimum acceptable kind of behavior, I think that you cannot underplay the importance of those. You must also appreciate that for any kind of conduct to go on to the extent that we complain about as egregious abuse, there must have been some violence within the society that made it acceptable and made it even possible. So an opportunity for the whole society to begin to discuss its moral values is absolutely important for going forward. Then these mechanisms also have built within their mandates responsibility for institutional reform. That is invaluable in helping the society to retrace its steps, to reform its institutions, to serve the people better. So yes, I think in the main, the broader notion of justice, yes, it absolutely does contribute. I think that that case has proceeded so far that it would be wise not to say too much about it, because it is now before an extraordinary chamber. But it has taken a long journey to get there, but it has got there. And I think we have to acknowledge the fact, we have to acknowledge the contribution of Senegal in being willing to take this on. And for the future, perhaps it will send signals that even that Africa is willing to take on even its own heads of state for what they do when they are in power. They are little victories, but we must celebrate them and move on from there. Perhaps the granting of criminal jurisdiction to the African court will be a good follow-up to this ad hoc tribunal on Hissène Habré, and we must acknowledge that and use the lessons to go forward. It is good to bring people from all walks of life, academics, activists in civil society, representatives of institutions and so on, together to think together about the issues that face them. Sometimes there's a gulf between those who are reflecting on the state of Africa and those who are actually doing work on the state of Africa, and those who stand to benefit from the work that is being done. So when you bring people from all sides together, we can only win. The important thing is for theory to shape practice, but for practice also to recognize the value of theory, and for us to listen to the beneficiaries and to shape our work according to the expectations of the beneficiaries. We who are here are very privileged members of African communities. Anybody with university education in Africa belongs to a privileged class, because not many people have the chance. And when we have the chance, we then have a responsibility to put our skills at the behest of our less fortunate compatriots. So bringing people together like this to talk about the continent and about issues that face the continent can only be helpful towards shaping our future.